Hello everyone, I welcome you in this series of Constitution, and at present we are discussing directive principles of state policy. In immediate previous presentation, we have seen what exactly do we mean by directive principles, and what are the importance, why it is important to be added in the Constitution, and how it is helpful to achieve the goal which is set in the Constitution. So we have seen these all basic things in previous presentation, and now in this presentation we are directly going to touch the point and see which directive principles are mentioned in the Constitution. So let's begin and we'll see one by one. See, first of all, these directive principles are not categorized originally in the Constitution. But as per, you know, their ideas and thoughts and ideologies, we can classify these directive principles in three parts or three types. One is socialistic principles, second is Gandhian principle, and third is liberal intellectual principles. We can classify all these directive principles in these three categories. Okay, so let's see one by one, and first we will deal with the socialistic principles. As you can see, Article 38, it reads that promote the welfare of the people by securing a social order through justice. What kind of justice? Social justice, economic justice, and political justice. To minimize inequalities in income, status, facilities, and opportunities. So if you see this, it looks like very idealistic in nature, okay, and very, we can say, affectionate, or we can say very interesting, right? Because every country wants this to achieve. What it simply means that we have to maintain justice or deliver justice. What kind of justice? We have to have social justice also, economic justice also, and political justice also. And when we are talking about this justice, why it is required? It is required to minimize the inequalities in income. Okay, so that the gap between rich and poor will not be, you know, more and more, as we can see in present society. So here they are saying that the gap between rich and poor should be minimized. Right? It should be very low. Or rather, there should not be any gap between rich and poor. All people should be equal in society, whether it is in terms of social, economics, or politics. So in all these three aspects, it is expected that the people will be treated equally on all three grounds, right? And equal status will be there, facilities will be provided equally, as well as opportunities will also be provided equally. So these things are required. And this is what is being read in Article 38. Now let's take next one, Article 39. What it says that you have to secure citizens' right to adequate means of livelihood for all citizens. Means what? Government should try to provide all those things to citizens or people which are required for their livelihood. Okay. Like for example, good quality water, right? Filtered water, then good quality food, right? Shelter, or these all, you know, clothing. These all are basic needs. And government should always try to fulfill these basic needs of the people. Okay. Along with that, equitable distribution of material resources of the community for the common good. Okay. Equal distribution of material resources. Whatever wealth you have, whatever resources you have, it should be distributed equally without any kind of discrimination. Prevention of concentration of wealth and means of production. See, this is a very important point one can understand, or one has to understand, that whatever wealth we are having, whatever property we are having, that should not be concentrated in the hands of few rich people. Rather, it should be distributed to all the people equally, so that everyone can uplift themselves. Okay, so again, it is all about, let's say, removing the gap between rich and poor. Next one is equal pay for equal work for men and women. Many times we see that men get more salaries and women get less salary or wages, and it is very apparent, right? So again, constitution is saying that government should try to bring men and women on parallel line when it comes to pay, right? Or payment or salaries or wages. So men and women should get equal wages. If both are working equally, so why should there be, you know, the gap between men and women? If they are doing the same thing, so the pay or wages should also be same. Okay. Next one is preservation of health and strength of workers and children against forcible abuse. You have to maintain these things. We have to ensure that the health of the people, right, workers and children especially, will be maintained, and government will make necessary actions, or they will take necessary actions to ensure better health for the people, right? Then opportunities for healthy development of children. Again, children's health is also important, and the government should try to maintain their health as well. Okay, so this was about Article 39, and next article we have to discuss about Article 39A. Let's talk about this also. That it says that promote equal justice and free legal aid to the poor. What it means that we have to ensure justice, right? We have to ensure that justice will be delivered to each and every section of the society, each and every individual of the society. And for that, what one should do, free and legal aid should be provided to the poor. Because if you have a poor person, right, and if he is, we can say, facing the trial, or if he is, we can say, having dialogues in the judiciary, so what should be the way through which he can have dialogue through? In short, we can say that there should be someone who should, you know, advocate him or her in the judiciary or in the court. So those who are rich people, they can hire, you know, private advocates by giving thousands and lakhs of rupees to the advocates. But what about the poor? If they are not having the money, what they will be doing, what they can do, right? In such case, it becomes necessary to provide advocate, right, to the one who is poor, okay, who cannot afford to have the advocate. Then it becomes the duty of government to provide free advocate to that poor person, so that injustice will not be done with that person. Okay, so this is what is expected in Article 39A of the Constitution. Now let's see what the next point says. Article 41. In case of unemployment, old age, and we can say sickness and disablement, wherein he or she cannot work, so what government should do? You know, government should provide, you know, right to work, then right to education, and right to public assistance. Government should ensure that those who are old age, they should get the pension, or they should get some amount of wages, right? Whether they are sick or disabled, they should get some kind of assistance from the government. Okay. Article 42 reads that make provision for just and human conditions of work and maternity relief. Means what? Those people who are working in, can say, various companies or factories or mines, anywhere, the working condition should be improved. Okay. The working condition of that company or office should be improved, so that, you can say, just condition will be there, and all people can work with free mind without any kind of stress. Then you have Article 43, which says that secure a living wage, a decent standard of living, and social and cultural opportunities for all workers. Right? Decent, we can say living standard of living should be maintained. Decent standard of living should be introduced by the government so that everyone can live a happy life, right, without any kind of problem. Right? Decent life will be provided. Next point is Article 43A, take steps to secure the participation of workers in the management of industries. Initially, we know that only, you know, management was taking all the decisions, but now government is trying to add or make workers participate in the management so that decision making process will be like based on consent. Workers' representatives will be there in the management of industries, and then the side of workers, opinion of workers will also be reflected in the decision making process of that industry or company. The next article says that raise the level of nutrition and the standard of living of people and to improve public health. Again, public health is government's most concerned issue, right? And therefore, government should try to increase the level of nutrition so that every person will get good kind of or good amount of nutrition, and he or she can, you know, improve their health. For that reason only, you need a good amount of nutrition. Now let's have a look at Gandhian principle. What Gandhian principle says, we will see one by one about this. Article 40 says that there should be a village panchayat. Okay, there should be village panchayat, which already we have, right? We have gram panchayat, we have panchayat samiti, then zilla parishad, and at urban level you have, we can say, municipality, municipal corporation, right? So these are all, we can say, small units of governance. And for that reason only we have brought all, we can say that the real sense of democracy, right, real sense of direct democracy will be achieved. So as a part of that, self-government is introduced, or to which we call local government or panchayati raj, okay, in India. So it is, we can say that the powers should be slowly and steadily transferred to villages and small units so that they can govern themselves, right? Next one is Article 43. It says that promote the cottage industry, right? We all know that Gandhi was, we can say, very fond of cottage, and he was very fond of, we can say, indigenous goods, right? And he says that as per, you know, his thinking, this provision is added in the constitution. Promote cottage industry on an individual, or we can say cooperation basis in rural areas, so that everybody will get the employment and they can also improve their standard of living. Then we have Article 43B. It says that promote voluntary formation, autonomous functioning, and democratic control and professional management of cooperative society. Right? Cooperative societies are there, like, for example, milk industry, for example, sugar factories, right? Or we can say banks, public banks. These all are, we can say, examples of cooperatives or cooperative societies. So in short, it says that we should promote cooperative societies. Next one says that promote the educational and economic interest of SCs and STs and other weaker sections of the society, to protect them from social injustice and exploitation. So those which are weaker sections in the society, government should try to promote them, right, through some or the other way, and they should be saved from exploitation. And injustice should not be done in any case. Okay. The next one says that prohibit the consumption of intoxicating drinks and drugs which are injurious to health. Whatever is injurious to health, that should be banned, that should be prohibited. Whatever is, you know, dangerous for the health, that should be completely prohibited. So for that also there should be the provision. Then next one says that prohibit the slaughter of cows, calf and other milch and draught cattle and to improve their breeds. So in short, it is all about prohibiting slaughters of animals. Animal slaughter should not be there, and animals should be can say saved from slaughterhouse. Okay, so here in short we can say it is all about protecting the animals and their life. Next one, again in that series only, liberal intellectual principles. This is the third one, and article 44 says that secure for all citizens a uniform civil code throughout the country. It says that government should try to bring uniform civil code, and we must know that there is a demand for uniform civil code, and even we can say various political parties also promise bringing uniform civil code, but even today it is, we can say, not brought in India. As I said that as per the time and situation all policies will be implemented. So whenever the proper and appropriate time will be there, so uniform civil code will also be implemented in the country. Next article says that provide early childhood care and education for all children until they complete the age of 6 years. So it is about providing education and early childhood care. Next article 48, it says that organize agriculture and animal husbandry on modern and scientific lines. Okay, so it's all about agriculture, and in agriculture also it should be done on scientific lines, right? Agriculture should be done in a manner which will be scientific. Okay, so for that reason article 48 is there. Then article 49 is there. It says that protect monuments, places and objects of artists or historic interest which are declared to be of national importance. Those which are national monuments and places or heritages, right? They are, we can say, historical places, places, and those historical places are required to be or supposed to be protected by the government and by the people as well. The next one says that separate the judiciary from the executive in public services of the state. So it says that executive should not interfere in the judiciary. Okay, so that if executive starts interfering in the judiciary, there is a higher possibility that the justice may not be delivered properly. So that was about separation of judiciary, so that, you know, even if judicial executive try to interfere in judiciary, that should not be, you know, possible for the executive, and therefore such provisions are made that judiciary will be kept independent, right, from the interference of the executive. Okay. Now article 51, it says that promote international peace and security. We should try, the government of India should try to maintain international peace. We should not interfere in, you know, the foreign countries' internal issues. We have to maintain international peace and security by, you know, just you have to honor their, you know, treaties. You have to respect treaties so that, you know, each and every country will respect everyone, and this way the international peace will be maintained. So treaties are there, everyone has to follow that, and every country has to respect international laws as well. And last one is, it says that encourage settlement of international disputes by arbitration. If any international issue is there, someone should arbitrate, someone should mediate, and then immediately that issue can be resolved. So one should try to resolve those issues by arbitration. And now let's see a few, you know, directive principles which are added later in the constitution. initially it was not part of constitution, but later on it is added by 42nd Amendment Act. Okay, so Article 39, it reads that to secure opportunities for the healthy development of children. Okay, again, it's all about nutrition and healthy development of children. Why it is focused? Because when you focus more on children, ultimately they are the future of India, right? These children are going to become, you know, future of India, young India. So therefore you need to focus more on children and their development. Article 39A, it reads that to promote equal justice and to provide free legal aid to the poor. Just now, as we discussed previously, that we have to think of this, providing free legal aid to the poor who cannot afford to have advocate with him or her, right? To advocate the voice or to raise the voice of poor, you should provide free legal advocate to the poor. Next one is Article 43A, to take steps to secure the participation of workers in the management of industries. We have seen this point also, right? So that, you know, management decision will become unanimous and the voice of workers will be heard at management level. And the last one is Article 48A, to protect the improvement, to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard forest and wildlife. Right? We have to protect the wildlife also, forest also, because we all know that whatever oxygen we get, it is coming from the forest, right? Trees. Trees are generating oxygen, right? And therefore we can say environment is highly essential. And for that reason only we have given, you can say, place in the constitution. And we have added this article or provision in Article 48A. So these are the four newly added, you can say, articles in the directive principles of state policy. So I hope you understood and got some knowledge out of this. And you must have understood what do we mean by directive principles of state policies and what all are there. We have discussed each and every article in detail. And I thank you at the end for patiently listening. Thank you.